And in seeking to expose these beliefs of these deviated groups, we're not attacking people. Rather, this is an invitation to our brothers and sisters in Islam. Come back, learn your aqidah. Learn your aqidah from the Quran and from the Sunnah, not from somebody who comes 1400 years, 1300 years later, and he actually contradicts that which the Prophet ﷺ and his companions radiallahu anhum ajma'in were upon. Study your aqidah, go back to the works of your founding fathers, see what they were upon. So it's extremely important that we have firm foundations. And foundations in this deen are that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down in the Quran, that which we have in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as understood by the companions and the first three generations of scholars and all those people who follow in their footsteps. I'm going to mention his works, his words, from majority of it is from his book called Al-Malfuzat. This is like, it's a book of his, which it contains a lot of his sayings, and from his sayings, we can derive his beliefs. And actually, there's not a lot of interpretation needed, because this man, he made it so clear what he was upon, that when you just read it, and you listen to it, you don't need to interpret it. It doesn't really need to be explained. Alhamdulillah, the falsehood is absolutely clear. The first thing that I want to mention, those people who call themselves or upon Brelwiya, they always call themselves Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. They always call themselves the Sunni Muslims. They always call themselves, we are the haqq, we follow, you know, we are the Sunnis and nobody else is Sunni. We need to look at why this term Sunni, it was derived. The term Sunni was used to differentiate between those who were Shia and those who were not. So you're either Sunni or you are Shia. And it's not enough to just say, we are Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, and now you consider, because you've given yourself this term, you are the haqq. Another proof that they use that they are upon truth and everybody else is upon falsehood, they say, well, look, there are more of us. And the Prophet ﷺ said, you know, and they mentioned this big group, Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, and they say, look, we are the Jama'ah. There's more of us than there are of you. Therefore, we are upon the haqq, you are upon the falsehood. Ikhwani, how is this any different to what the Quraysh said to the Messenger ﷺ? How can we and our forefathers, how can we be incorrect? How can we be incorrect? The uncle of the Prophet ﷺ, Abu Talib, when he died, the Prophet ﷺ was saying, look, just say La ilaha illallah. I will, you know, intercede for you with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those who were around him, Abu Jahl, etc., they said, are you going to forsake the religion of your forefathers? So, ikhwani, we have to question ourselves. If this is our mindset, that what I am born upon, what I am raised upon is the truth, then ask yourself the question, if you were born a Hindu, if you were born a Sikh, would you come to the haqq? Would you come to Islam? Because your attitude would be, I'm born a Sikh, I'm born a Hindu, and my forefathers are upon this, how could they all be wrong? So then we have to understand that we as Muslims, our search is for the haqq, our search is for the truth. The Messenger alayhi salam said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned this in the Quran. The companions were upon this. This is our religion. It's not based on numbers. It's not based on strength of men, etc. Let's remember that there will be prophets on Yawm al-Qiyamah who will come followed by 10 people. One will come followed by five people. And the Messenger alayhi salam has mentioned others will come and they will be completely alone. They will be completely alone. So do we say that those people who never accepted them were on the haqq because there were more of them? No. We take the haqq even if we are the only person upon that. Ya Sheikh, do we have Muslims from amongst the jinn and the angels as well? He replied, an angel became Muslim and she would often come to visit me. An angel became Muslim and she would often come to visit me. One day she did not come, so I questioned her. And she replied, one of my close friends died in Hindustan. So I went there and on the way, I saw Iblis praying her salah. This is in Al-Malfuzat, chapter number 1. I think it's the 29th saying in his book. So he affirms that there are angels who some are Muslim and some are not. And he says that the angels, he mentions that this angel is female. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions about the Quraysh, the pagan Quraysh, do you yourself take sons and then you make the angels the daughters of Allah? I.e. you make them women, you make them feminine. He is doing the same thing, Ikhwani, and then he falls into this major error. Ahmed Raza Khan replied, it was on the river of Hadiqa where Sayyidi Junaid Baghdadi was traveling and he started to walk on the water as he did on the land. An important point here. We mentioned last week how the Deobandis, they gave unhuman or superhuman characteristics to their awliya. They gave superhuman characteristics to their awliya. Here we have Ahmed Raza Khan giving this same thing to Junaid Baghdadi. He walked on the water as he did on the land. So, he says, another man who was behind him also needed to get across that same river, but there was no boat at the time. He saw Junaid walking across the water, so he asked, how may I cross? So Junaid is walking on the water, as the Christians say Isa alayhi salam did. He was walking on the water, a man behind him says, look, I need to get to that same place on the other side of this water. What do I do? So Junaid says, listen to this. Listen to what Ahmed Raza Khan says, says that Junaid Baghdadi said to this man. He says, say, Ya Junaid, Ya Junaid. So the man did this and he started to say, Ya Junaid, Ya Junaid. And he started to walk on the water as he did on the land. Again, they call upon their awliya for things that nobody can give to you. Things that are not in their ability, and they call upon them. When he reached the middle, so this man has started reached his middle now, so he started walking on the water saying, Ya Junaid, Ya Junaid. This is the only thing that's keeping him afloat. Ahmed Raza Khan continues, he says, when he reached the middle, the accursed shaitan put whisperings in his heart and Junaid started to say, Ya Allah. Ikhwani, look at this clear kufr, clear disbelief. You're calling upon Junaid and he says shaitan comes to him and he puts whisperings into his heart and the man now starts to say, Ya Allah. He actually starts to call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The accursed shaitan put whisperings in his heart that Junaid is saying, Ya Allah. And he said to me, say, Ya Junaid. So I started to say, Ya Allah. And he immediately fell into the water. Immediately, when he called upon Allah, he fell into the water. He says, the man who's fallen in, he said, oh Junaid, I'm going to die. So Junaid said, say, Ya Junaid, Ya Junaid. He started to say again, and eventually he crossed the river. He says, why is it that when you say Ya Allah, you don't drown? But when I say Ya Allah, I drown. Junaid said, oh my childish one, you have not even reached Junaid yet, and you want to reach Allah? Ikhwani, look at this. Look at this. Again, this is evidence of the Sufi or the Brelvi Aqidah. We need to go through intermediaries. And I mentioned it previously once before. If you want to get to the roof of the house, you use the ladder. If you want to get to the king, you speak to the ministers. Ikhwani, how do you set up an example to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his creation? Subhanallah amma yushrikun. And we mention how Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he says, look, why if you needed to go to a king, would you go through his ministers? Are you saying that normally you go to the king through his ministers because the king, he is biased and he doesn't listen to the ordinary folk? Are you saying Allah won't listen to you? Normally the king is too busy to listen to the ordinary folk, so he only listens to his ministers. Are you saying Allah is too busy to listen to you? Ikhwani, crazy, crazy beliefs. Again, this is in Al-Malfuzat 131. But look, he says the shaitan put whisperings into his heart, making him call upon Allah. So they will call upon everybody and his dog, but they won't call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third saying of Ahmed Raza Khan Brelvi. He says, there were two walis. And an important point here, again, we're just extracting points of benefit from the Brelvi Aqeedah. Two walis, they will call everybody a wali. If he wears a green turban and carries a tasbih and he has an orange beard and he seems pious, that's it. He is now a wali. He doesn't pray, he can't read Quran with tajweed, he's involved in riba, he's involved in ta'weez and shirk and magic and kufr, but he's a wali. And when he dies, he becomes an even bigger wali. This is from the Aqeedah, Ikhwani. Everybody and his dog is a wali. Ahmed Azakhan, he writes, there were two walis and they lived on either side of a wide river. They lived on either side of a wide river. One of them made rice pudding. What do we call rice pudding? Kheer. One of them made kheer. One of them made kheer and he told his servant to take it to his friend. The servant replied, oh master, how can I? There is a river in the way. How will I get across? I have no sailing equipment. And the man replied, this wali, he replies, go to the river and say to it, I have come from a man who has not slept with his wife. The servant was amazed as the wali had children. Ahmed Azakhan is saying this himself. So the man says, go to the river, speak to the river, and tell the river that you've come from a man who hasn't slept with his wife. And the man is amazed. Razakhan, he says, but this man, he was amazed because he had children. Nonetheless, he thought it was important to follow what the wali had said. Let's stop here. Blind following. Blind following. He hasn't slept with his wife, according to him, yet he has children. So then how does he have children? Are they like Isa alayhi salam, no father? Are they like Adam alayhi salam, no father? Ikhwani, common sense. But these people, in their blind following of their walis, they will kill a man who opposes their wali. They will burn a house down and they will do everything. They will attack you in defense of their wali. Not in defense of the Quran and the Sunnah and the Haqq. They will attack you blindly on the words of their wali. So he said, he thought it was important to follow what the wali had said. He did as he was instructed, and immediately a path formed between the river. Like Musa alayhi salam. Like Musa alayhi salam, when he had Fir'aun behind him, he had the river in front of him, and he struck it and the path opened up. So this wali has done something similar just by telling him to talk to it. He walked across and gave it to the other wali, who ate the rice pudding and said, give my salam to your master. And the servant replied, I can only do that when I get across the river. Now we know what's coming. The man's going to say, go to the river and tell it you've come from such and such. This wali on the other side of the river, he replied, say to the river, I have come from the one who has not eaten for 30 years, even though he's just eaten the kheer. Think about that. The servant was amazed. The servant was amazed as the wali had just eaten in front of him. He got to the river and he did as he was told, and another path was formed between the river and it gave way to him and he walked across. Ikhwani, subhanallah, clear cut kufr and shirk, clear cut ignorance, and yet they will blind follow their wali. They will blind follow their sheikh. They will blind follow anybody, Ikhwani, who comes to them with beautiful stories. You just bring a beautiful story and you can become their sheikh. This is in 131 and 32. What do they believe about their awliya? What do they believe about their awliya? We mentioned about the deals, the Deobandis. That there was a man who, when he wanted to go and do tawaf, he just used to take a couple of steps and he was immediately transported to Makkah. And he would do his tawaf. Other people we mentioned from the Deobandis, he was asked, I've come from the majlis of the queen. And he said, I walk on the suburbs so that the suburbs will become inhabited. All sorts of crazy things, Ikhwani. And we mentioned how they believe that Prophet alayhi salam learned Urdu from the scholars of Deoband, etc. Now let's look at one of the statements of Ahmed Reza Khan about what he says about his peer. He writes, our peer can be present in every place, in 10,000 places, in 10,000 cities at one time. 10,000 places, 10,000 cities at one time. Subhanallah. And he gives an example. It was possible for Sayyidi Fatih Muhammad Quddus to be present in 10 different gatherings at once. 10 different gatherings at once. And obviously from this, we have, from this corrupt aqidah, we have the fact that they believe that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam visits them in their majalis. When they are singing their Natan Sharif, and they are doing their Zikr Sharif, and they are doing their headbanging Sharif, they believe that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam comes and visits them. And so they stand up. They stand up. And to the ordinary man, they think, oh, we're just standing up now because it's heating up a little bit. You know, we're going to do some dance moves. But no, for those of them who are well-versed, they stand up in honor of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And you will even go to some places where they will have a chair like this one. I hope the brothers are not believing this aqidah. They will leave a chair like this one and it will be empty. And they will say, this is for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to sit on when he arrives. Look at this kufr, ikhwani, and it all stems from such beliefs. So he says 10,000 places, 10,000 sittings at one time, and then he mentions this man, Muhammad Quddus, and he could be in 10 gatherings at once. Then he gives an example for this. For his aqidah, the aqidah of Islam, look at the aqidah, or look at the example that he brings. He says, look at Christian Kehnaya. He was a disbeliever and he would also be able to be present in a number of places at once. So he says, because the disbelievers can do it, surely our awliya can do it. Another thing that he mentions about their awliya, he says the earth and the heavens cannot remain in existence if it were not for the presence of a ghawth. Now a ghawth, ikhwani, is like a person who they turn to and they say that he's been given special rights and authority by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he looks after the affairs of the creation. Let's talk about your aqidah. You make taqlid of Imam Abu Hanifa, they say yes. You say Allah is everywhere, they say yes. Didn't Imam Abu Hanifa say that the one who says he doesn't know where Allah is a kafir? Didn't Imam Abu Hanifa say that the one who says he doesn't know if Allah is above his arsh is a kafir? And then they will come and they will, because you've got them into a corner now, they come and they will attack you personally. And this is nothing new, ikhwani. About the Hanafi madhab, Raza Khan, he writes, the Hanafi madhab will be more beloved and liked by Allah and his messenger. We hear story, story, story. The same as the Diobandis. The same as the Diobandi elder scholars, story, story, story. We don't hear ayah of Quran, hadith, understanding of the Salaf. We hear story, and from these stories they derive their aqidah. It's very, very dangerous, ikhwani. Ahmad Raza Khan, he writes, and Sayyidi Abdul Wahhab Sha'rani was from the major awliya. On the grave of Sayyid Ahmad Badawi Kabir, there would be annual festivities and gatherings. Again, a characteristic of the Barelwis is they take their graves as places of worship. They take their graves as place of festivities, food, flowers, lights, dancing, everything. Abdul Wahhab went and he noticed a slave girl of a businessman. He looked away as the first look was by shaitan, but he liked the girl. So Abdul Wahhab carried unto the grave of Sayyidi Ahmad Badawi Kabir, and a voice was heard. So he's at this man's grave now. He's taken a look at this slave girl. He's liked her, but he's looked away, mashallah. Now he's gone to the grave of this holy man. And listen to what, and this man, the person who likes a slave, his name is Abdul Wahhab. Ironic. But he liked the girl. So Abdul Wahhab carried out and to the grave of Sayyidi Ahmad Badawi Kabir, and a voice was heard. Abdul Wahhab, do you like the slave girl? He replied, yes. I should not conceal anything from the Shaykh. So a voice was heard again. Okay, I have given you the girl as a gift. The person in the grave has given the slave girl as a gift to the man who's alive. But the man inside the grave is dead. Now Abdul Wahhab is silent and he's thinking that the girl belongs to the businessman. And Hazur is giving me her as a gift. Suddenly the businessman appeared and sacrificed the girl for the person in the grave. Then all of a sudden another voice was heard and it was said, Abdul Wahhab, what are you waiting for? Take her into the room and fulfill your desires. Al-Malfuzat 309 to 310. I'm not going to mention anything more on that because we have sisters in the room.